We are wrapping up our series on the Book of Ruth, and I'm up here to do like a summary recap. I feel like all our speakers was excellent, talking about from a right heart with Evangelist Sundin, to unshakable faith, week two with Michelle. And even last week, we actually had Dickness Dawkins talking about this concept of redemption and how are we redeemed. I'm going to be talking about today this concept of extraordinary. How I phrased it is extra ... ordinary. One of the things I'm actually going to try to be talking about and pulling out through the text is God is the extra in the ordinary.
Right.
I'm going to be pulling through that through the text and just really talking about has God the extra in the ordinary.
All right.
And this is a little bit different. I'm going to try to do a more of a traditional sermon thing. So usually where they teaching you how to preach before you go into sermon, you're supposed to read your text before you pray. So I'm going to try to do this traditional style today. And we're going to read, starting in chapter 1 of the Book of Ruth. We're going to read two passages from the Book of Ruth. Then after that, we're going to read one passage from the Book of Matthew, because the old and the new. You know, I do have some training. So this is what we're going to read. It says this in Ruth chapter 1, verse 11. It said this, "But Naomi said, 'Turn back, my daughter. Why would you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husband? Turn back, my daughter. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. And if I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear a son, would you therefore wait till they are grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughter. It is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that your hand of the Lord has gone against me." We're going to look at that'll be the book, front. We're going to look at the book end of Ruth chapter 4, verses 16 to 17. "Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. And the woman of the neighbor gave him a name, saying, 'A son has been born to Naomi.' And they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse and the father of David." We're going to jump into the New Testament. We're going to talk about some of this family dynamics. Matthew 1, verse 5, and it said, "And Samuel the follower of Boaz by Rahab." Oh, man, that's a good story. "And Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth. And Obed the father of Jesse," and Jesse, in verse 6, "and Jesse the father of David, the king. And the David was the follower of Solomon by the wife of Uriah." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God, we actually just come, God, that you might have a word for us all today, God. That, Father God, that as we are going through text today, God, that you make it as plain as day, God, that as you bring out the practicality of your word, God, that it might hit our hearts, God. It might encourage us, God, but it also might draw us to action, God. Father God, we actually just pray right now that Justin decrease, God, that they don't hear Justin, nor do they see Justin. All they hear and feel is your love. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The Book of Ruth is one of the books in the Bible that is one of the most fascinating books of the Bible, because it seems like it's the only book in the Bible that God does not speak. It's the only book of the Bible that God does not do an amazing miracle, right? There is no crossing the Red Sea. There is no flower or food just springing up out of the ground. There is no supernatural miracle, but at the same time, God is present. Some people would even say scholarly that the Book of Ruth is an ordinary book.
Ordinary.
It's just ordinary people just going through their ordinary day with their ordinary troubles. And at the end, there's a birth.
Come
But there's no special thing about this birth because Ruth had to wait 9 months before she birthed it, and she had a husband. Thus, it wasn't like a virgin birth, so it's just an ordinary birth. But nevertheless, in the context of what's going on in Scripture, God is present. Yes. And in the story, there's some extra in the ordinary. So today, I would like to actually go chapter by chapter and give you a point out of each chapter that I have gleaned. You know, we're talking about reaping. I glean from the text. Well, and that you might be able to apply it to your heart and actually move forward. So this is point number one. I'm going to start with point number one. After reading chapter one, this is my first point I came up with, is you have to lose your negative mind.
Come on.
Set.
All right.
Have to lose your negative mindset.
Come on.
Many times we are navigating through life and we're just negative. We're negative. Can't even take a compliment. You so negative, right? And I'm gonna show you how this is played out. First thing, no matter how bad things might be in your life, in God's will, it's always better than anywhere else. How the story starts off is that Elimelech is in Bethlehem.
Yes.
He has land. He's successful in Bethlehem, but because there's a rough season in his life, he says to himself, I'm about to go find something else. He has to leave his land, leave his inheritance out, looking for something better.
Come on.
It's an imagery of sometimes Christians are in churches, and because life is so terrible while I'm being a Christian, I say, man, this is not working for me. Let me go out and see what's else in this world.
Well, it's a grass green.
It's in this that he packs up his wife and he packs up his two boys and they go on a journey. Man, there was a time way back when I was thinking about just packing up and just moving and just leaving the city of Chicago. And the story that God brought me to was Elimelech.
Right.
And I was like, why are you bringing this to me? Because many times people move not thinking about where God wants them to be.
All right, Pastor, come on.
I'm gonna step on some toes, but I gotta do it. Hey. So many people move away from closeness to their church just because times are hard where they're at. And it's so happened is that people say, man, I got a job. I'm moving down to Texas. And you go, what about your church? Do you got church down there? Oh, you know, I'll figure it out when I get there. Because their primary goal isn't getting close to God, but it's about their pocketbooks.
All right.
So what we see in the story is that we see something that shouldn't have been good turn tragic. He actually packs his family up. He moves really, really far. And while he's really, really far, what it says is that his boys, when they're growing up in this environment and knew not God, they took on Moabite wives. But in the midst of all of that, God is present.
Yes.
You might say, God, Justin, how is God is present in the midst of that when both Elimelech and both of his sons die? Tragedy. First five books. It's tragic. Why? Because many times we're searching for things outside of the will of God, and God is saying, stay here. Stay here. Psalms 84:10 says it like this, and I actually like how David wrote it. He said, for a day in your court is better than 1,000 elsewhere. He actually then goes on, because a lot of people don't understand the context there. He said, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God. What's a doorkeeper is that back in this day in the Hebrew culture, in order to come into church, you had to be circumcised. So the doorkeeper's job was to look at people's junk.
What? Wow.
That was his job. That's a pretty terrible job.
Yeah.
Because I played basketball. I know you be musty down there. You got to, oh, gross, right? But it's really this idealist that he said, I'd rather do that just to be in the presence of God than be in a paradise somewhere else. And many times, we having a hard week. I've been praying to Pastor Justin, and God haven't talked to me for about a week, about a month. I don't know if this what I'm supposed to be doing. So you just stop going to church. You stop reading your Bible. You literally start to distance your heart, just like Amalek did, and things start falling apart.
Well, come on.
It's something about when things fall apart, people find their way back to church. So everything is fell apart, and Noemi is in the situation that she's saying to herself, I need to go back home. I need to press back into the presence of God. I need to get back to the presence of God.
Yes.
And I wrote this down to actually share with you. He said, it says, you don't know what chapter you are on in your life, so keep pressing into the presence of God.
Amen.
I don't care how old you is. Noemi is kind of old. I'm gonna just throw it out there. She had two grown sons. So she's not a young chick. But when we meet her, she's in chapter 1.
Come on.
Man, I'm get it back. Because all sometimes right. You're like, but Justin, I've been living for X, Y years.
All right. That's in chapter 1.
God is saying, maybe this is your chapter 1, is that I'm getting ready to write and change your life.
Come on.
Man, somebody need to hear this. No, Amy's life was changed in 1 year, the scripture tells us. 1 year, the whole life was changed. You don't know what chapter you're on. I don't care if you're 30, I don't care if you're 50, I don't care if you're 70. God hands in there, he was like, I still can write the end of your story. So I'm going to say this. We got to lose our negative mindset. But Pastor Justin, this have already been my life. Bad things always happen to me. You have to lose that in order for God to do it in your life. So I wrote this down, and I want to share. It says, stop speaking down on yourself, not knowing what God is doing in your life.
All right.
You have to stop speaking down. Look at what Noemi told Ruth. And, I'm actually saying with Michelle preached on. She says in Ruth chapter 1, verse 20, and she said to them, she talked to her daughters, do not call me. She said, do not call me Noemi. So she's coming back to the Bethlehem, this is the context, and she tell them, do not call me Noemi. What Noemi mean is a sweet fragrance.
Yes.
A sweet fragrance, really, to God. She said, don't call me sweet. Call me martyr. That's a bitter herb. For the Almighty have done very bitter with me. I went away fool, and the Lord have brought me back empty. Why call me Noemi when the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty have brought calamity upon me? So Amy returned and Ruth the Moabite, her daughter-in-law, with her, who returned from the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley season. I actually liked that because she's talking bad about her life. Man, I don't know about you, but how many of you guys get a compliment and UNC start talking down to you? But man, nice shirts. Oh, man, this ain't nothing. I just got it on sale. I can't even tell thank you. I instantly start talking the unconscious negativity over my life.
Come on. I'll force it with my right words. Come on.
This is how it is with the incident that Michelle preached a couple weeks is that Ruth is like, I want to come back. She's like, don't come back with me. I'm terrible. I don't got nothing to offer.
All right.
How many times have you disqualified yourself from speaking life into somebody because of what your past would look like?
Yes.
How many times have you looked at your life and said, I can't teach nobody. I don't.
Same.
Man, I actually love when people say that. I say, man, you should pray with someone. You should mentor someone. They say, how am I going to mentor them? I'm still scratching up trying to pay my own bills. Can't teach them nothing. You can teach them about the godliness that's inside of you. This is why God picks Noemi and partner her with Ruth. They both was broke.
That's
They were both in a situation. But one knew how to seek the Father's heart. And she's saying to herself, I'm broke.
Well,
I don't got nothing. I just go to church on Sunday. Then take her with her. Whatever God has placed in your heart is way more valuable than anything else you can possess. And I actually love this because, no, Amy's destiny is tied up in Ruth. Man, I'm about to preach to someone because someone needs to hear this. Listen, God want to bless Noemi, but she pushing Ruth away. Sometimes God trying to bless you with things and you just pushing your blessing away. I don't need that. I don't need that. Man, you know, I had a bad time when like people used to try to gift me stuff. They used to try to gift me like $20. I'd be like, no, I'm good. I'm good. I'm good. I'm good. I'm good. Good. Noemi. Hey, I want to bless you with something. Oh, no, no, I don't need that. No, Noemi. Why? Because you feel like I don't deserve it. It's hard for you to just say, thank you. I don't got to say nothing else but thank you. Don't even have to question why you want to put it in my hand, but thank you. Sometimes God knows you need in a season and you're struggling within it because you keep speaking down on your life. You keep talking negative to yourself. But that phrase at the end that I love, it says, they got back to Bethlehem in the beginning of barley season. If God is in it, there's always hope. The writer writes that because he's saying that they empty, they don't have anything, but where they're going is prospering. Man, I don't know about you. You need to get somewhere where it's prospering, it's growing. There's a harvest. Get to church, get to church, get to church. Point number two, chapter two. That was just all in chapter one. It's a lot, right? Chapter two. This is what I pulled out of chapter 2, and I want to share this. For God to give you extra in your life, you have to be willing to leave your comfort zone and step into Christ's will for your life.
Okay.
You got to leave your comfort zone.
All right. Stretch out on faith.
I don't know who is like, man, but I'm doing good. Yeah. He's saying, I require more. I require more. I require more. I don't care how bad your life has been up to this point. I wrote this down. I want to share with you. Get up and do what God requires of you.
Amen.
Ruth chapter 2, verse 2 to 3, this is what happens. Ruth have lost a husband. She had lost a father-in-law. She just left her country. She don't know her mom and dad. She lost everything, and now she's in a random place. And it would make sense that she should be depressed. She should be moping. She should be like, man, I'm a realtor. Poor on me. Look what Ruth does. It says this, and Ruth the Moabite said to Noemi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of the grain after him in whose sight I might find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. The first thing she said is, I'm about to get up and go get a job.
Right.
How many times have you been beating up on yourself about the same thing?
Come on. Sitting on the couch.
You know what I'm saying? I was in school. I failed out. Get up and reapply.
Right. Keep at it.
You know, I had a job. I like lost my job. Get up and reapply. Go do what is required of you. Many times we can get woe is me syndrome.
All right.
But Ruth didn't have that. She says, I'm about to go out and just do what I have to do. And I'm hoping that I find favor in somebody's eye. I'm hoping that I come across a blessing. Man, listen, the extra is found in your expectation for a miracle. She's expecting that I'm going to find favor in someone's sight. And look what how the text continues to go. She says, go. So she set her out, and she went, and she gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan of Elimelech. In the will of God, there's no such thing as luck.
No.
But events that are part of his purpose, his will for your life.
Yes.
Listen, listen. She woke up that morning and she says, I'm just going to go out and work. And as she was doing what she was supposed to do.
Come on.
Man, listen. Man, I'm about to single people. Listen to me here. She wasn't saying, I'm about to go find me a man. That was not what she said to do. She said, I'm about to do what I'm supposed to do.
Right. God will work it out.
And as she was doing what she's supposed to do,
God was doing his work. Come on.
She happened to come about. She happened to stumble into the thing that her heart secretly desired into the start of that story.
Amen.
Man, listen. Man, listen here. Many times we are saying to ourselves, hey, I want a better job. Do what you're supposed to be doing. Do what you're supposed to be doing.
Yes.
Right? Do what you're supposed to be doing. Man, listen, I'm gonna give you my testimony. I'm in software engineering, software development, didn't go to college for it. Actually, we learned how to build websites serving my church.
Come on, working in the church.
Right? I was serving my church, helping them try to build the best website possible. And it so happened to happen. I just stumbled my way into a blessing. Why? You do what you're supposed to do. I don't know about what God is pressing on your heart or what you, where you should be focusing on. Get there.
Amen.
Get there. Stop chasing what you think you should be chasing and do what he called you to do. It's so happen to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Listen.
Yes.
This is what the text says. In Romans 8:28.
Extraordinary.
And we quote this all the time. He says, and we know. Why don't you know by now?
All right. Woo, Jesus.
That for those who love God, man, I love that qualifier. You know, I could preach this whole that you have to love God.
Hey, glory.
Sometimes we're in a situation that God is working on your heart and saying, how much do you love me?
Well,
that when things are getting up, do you still get up and do what I asked you to do? I love God. All things work together for the good. Who those who are called according to his purpose is real. When you are living your life in the purpose and the will of God, it starts to fall together.
Yes.
It starts to come together.
Yes.
It starts to make sense. It probably didn't make sense in chapter 1. And it still don't make sense to chapter 2, but we get there. It just happened to happen. It's a hint that God is moving in your life. Man, I'm telling you, there's so many relationships that just happen to happen. Talking to people, having friends with people, and they just happen to live to their salvation.
All right.
Why? Because God is in the midst. You know, it might seem ordinary, but God is there, so it's extra ordinary.
Yes.
It's feel like a battle. Listen, being at the right place at the right time is part of God.
Yes.
Come on.
Being at the right place at the right time is part of God. Meeting the right person is part of God's will. Man, this is what I love about this story, and I'm going to share this, is that Ruth was in danger. She didn't even know she was in danger.
All right. Bring it out, Pastor. Bring it out.
She was in danger. Why? She's a young widow woman walking around with no protection.
That's right.
That's true. Boy.
She in trouble. She's in danger. Listen. unseen protection.
Oh, glory. God had a hand.
It's God.
Yes.
How do we know that the thing, man, if you keep reading the story, Boaz has a conversation with her and he said, don't go nowhere else.
That's right.
And I told everybody not to touch you. It gets a little bit more better than later when she talked to her mother-in-law, Noemi. Nope. Noemi said, man, girl, you lucky that you didn't get robbed.
All right.
Where have you been? And she told her, Boaz, she said, you need to stay there unless you get jacked. It's pretty much what she said in so many words. And it's really this ideal is that sometimes we live in ordinary lives and God doing some extraordinary protection in our lives. Extraordinary thing that you're not driving down the street and get shot.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? You're not just driving and someone runs the red light and T-bone your car.
Say it.
Thank you, God, for protection.
It's extraordinary. He's like, man, I'm working miracles. If like you would have seen the dangers that was creeping on this, but I will say this, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. I don't care what they're forming.
Yeah.
It won't work. It's the unseen protection that God said, man, I'm in the midst. It looked ordinary.
Hey! But it's extraordinary.
But it's extraordinary. It's divine.
Come on,
thank you, Jesus.
Come on, Pastor.
Man, listen. But it's not only the unseen protection, it's the unseen provision. What we see in the text is that Boaz comes to his servant and says, who's this young lady? And they say, oh, don't you know Noemi's situation? That's the Moabite girl.
Yeah.
And he says, oh, okay, this is what I want you guys to do for her. Right? As she's gleaming, I want you to drop a little extra.
Hey! God's a provider. Come on.
I want you to drop her in there. She had no idea. Unseen provision.
Yep. Thank you, Jesus.
Unseen provision. God is working on your behalf. You don't even know. People are discussing your promotion right now. You don't even know it.
Oh, wow.
There's literally people who are sitting in a room saying, we need to hire this person. Where they're at. I'm telling you, it happened. They sitting there like, we need these qualifications. We need this type of background. And we can't find them. Where they at?
It's
unseen.
Yes.
And you just gonna submit your ordinary resume.
Yes.
God's gonna make it extra.
You're gonna make it extra. Why? It's how he works. It's how he works. I'm telling you guys, this is how it works. And the Book of Ruth amplifies that. She's so happy to fall in there. Listen to this. I want to share this with you. What you do in God's eyes matter. I'm talking to everyone, your simple day-to-day life. Well, everything you do in God's eyes matter. You don't know, but the simple things has an impact. The simple things in your life has an impact.
Yes.
You might say, what you're talking about? Let's look at scripture. Let's look at Ruth chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. Boaz is talking to her, and he said, hey, girl, you can work here. Don't get away. And she said, how did I find favor? What did I do that makes you want to help me so much? And this is what he said. Listen, but Boaz answered her and said, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and your mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know.
Whoa,
verse 12, the Lord repays you for what you have done.
Yes.
A full reward will be given to you by the Lord. He's not saying by me. He's saying, listen. God has seen what you've been doing. He has seen your faithfulness. He has seen your commitment. He has seen your obedience. He has seen your desire to pursue righteousness. And guess what? He's taking notes. And and people are talking about you. You think it's ordinary. I'm just doing what I'm supposed to do. I wake up every day, take care of my kids. It's a blessing in taking care of your kids. I just wake up, pay my bills on time. I don't see nothing extraordinary about it, but because God is in your midst. He's working on things that are supernatural. I mean, listen. You can go to your job and do the ordinary task.
Whoa! Come on, let's see what God.
But because you do it under the favor and under the anointing of God, the bosses and them start giving you promotions and raises, and everybody like, I do the same thing, but you don't got the extra.
All right.
Woo!
Jesus. Listen. Because her faith was put into God, she said, Noemi, your God gonna be my God.
Yes.
God started putting extra in her life.
Thank you, Jesus.
God started putting extra in your life. He said, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge.
Jesus.
I don't know about you, but I need God to cover me everywhere I go.
Yes.
Every single moment, every single second, I need the presence of God to be around me. Man, he go to old folks, you used to have a son. Jesus be a fence.
All around me.
All around me.
Yeah.
Why? I need the protection in my life.
Yes.
I need to be in your midst.
Yes.
I need to be in your pavilion, as the Psalms writer said it. I need to be where you are. There's something that needs to take place in your heart that you're willing to follow God wherever he goes. So I have a couple questions. I got two questions for you to think about. What have God called you to be faithful in? What is God calling you to be faithful in this season?
All right.
Hallelujah.
Are you faithful? Are you committed? You might say, I think I'm faithful. Go see God. Ask that question. Am I faithful in what God calls me to be in? I got a second question. Are you trying to move on to the next without being faithful to the now?
Ooh, I like that.
That's powerful.
Man, say it again, Pastor.
Man, are you trying to move on to the next without being faithful to the now?
Amen.
This is something that I've learned. This is something that my mom has taught me. Is that you can't be asking for something new and you don't take care of what you got.
All right.
Many times, we like, God, I need a new job. But you come late to work at this kind of job. God, I need better relationships. Talk to my single people. I need somewhere in my life. I need a better relationship. But you are struggling with the current relationships that you got.
All right.
You're trying to get to the next. And God said, I need you faithful to what's in front of you now. I need you faithful with the things that he had put in your life now, and say, I'm going to be faithful to these things until God can bring me to the next. So, point number three is this. You must be willing to follow godly wisdom that is outside of your emotion and logic. Chapter 3. This is what I get to chapter 3. Ruth, young girl. Noemi, older, wiser woman of God. Ruth, single. She have a desire. Her mom-in-law said, hey, if you listen to me, you're going to get married. But you have to listen and do everything I tell you to do exactly how I tell you to do it. Man, I was reading that text and I said, man, why is the young woman in the church so hard-headed these days? Don't want to sit down and talk to the mothers of the church.
Same.
Don't want to sit there and glean wisdom from the mother of the church. I'm talking about the young man too. Hard-headed. Think you know it all. New phrase that me and Robbie use, you're an intellectual fool. Got all this knowledge, but no, have no wisdom.
All right.
Right? She listened outside of her emotions. Man, listen. Listen. Boaz is old. We're going to get to that in a few minutes. He's an old man. Ain't her type. Nah, nah, nah. It's not always about your type.
Say it again.
I'm about to hear this. And guess what? All the single people say, yeah, this word ain't for me. Gotta be somebody else he preaching this for. This ain't my word. But this your word. Boaz is an old man. And her mom is saying, listen, stop looking at how he looks. Look at his character.
All right.
He's faithful. Man, listen. I love how this story set it up. He said, he's good to his workers. He's good to his employees. He's good to the people that he don't have to be good to.
All right. Compassion. Come on.
It's something about his heart that, I'm telling you, he's the one. Man, listen. If you get Google-eyed and you don't have your ear open to the older women who's saying, I'm watching this boy.
Come out, something ain't right.
They ain't the one. She said, no, his character is right. This is what I want you to do. Wait until he get filled. He eat, he drink, he get married. Wait until that moment, then go tell him that you want him to marry you. Man, I love this. I'm gonna share this to you, right? Women in the church, men are stupid. I don't mean to say it like that, but sometimes we need a hint. We need a hint that you like us too. Especially if you out our lead. Listen, he needed a hint. You know what I'm saying? Look, Boaz seen her, but he wasn't approaching her because he was like, man, she's fine. She's young. I'm just an old rag. She had to go to him and say, hey, I like you. Do you like me? I like you. Okay, let's do this. You might say, Pastor Jesse, I'm telling you, it's in the scripture. It's in the word. She had to give him a hint. She had to give him a hint. And like, this is what he says, and I actually love what he says. Let's look at Ruth chapter 3, verse 10. He said this, and he said, May you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. You have made this last kindness greater than the first, in that you have not gone after a younger man, whether poor or rich. Because something like them poor. I don't know about you. But, and now, my daughter, you do not fear. I will do for you all that you ask. For all my fellow townsmen know that you are a worthy woman. Man, listen. He didn't say, because you fine. He said, man, I'm going after you because I know everyone knows that you are a woman of godly character. But what about her past? We don't care.
Come on.
Why? She's a godly woman. I don't care if that she's a Moabite. I don't care if she's a widower with no kids.
Say it.
She's worthy. Yeah. Man, listen. I need to preach this to someone because someone probably don't feel like you're worthy today because of your past.
Come on.
And what God said, man, you might have been on the dating scene and you. And like you've been probably had a lot of people treat you like you're not worthy, but God is saying, I have someone who's going to be able to see your worth.
Hey!
Yes.
So he looks at her and he says, you're worthy. You're a worthy woman. Verse 12. He said, and now it is true. I am a redeemer. Hold up. Yet there is a redeemer nearer than I. Man, I want to leave this with you guys, is that before the wheel, there's always something that's closer, where it might not be right.
Oh, wow. Might be closer, but
it ain't right. It's something that might be
shortcut.
How you want it, the young, rich, fine, you know, thank deaconess, you know, right? Might be everything you desire.
Hey!
But it ain't right.
All right.
Ain't in the will of God.
It's not right. The question is, are you going to go for the right thing or the quick thing? Oh, I'm gonna rephrase that so you can get it. Are you gonna go for the right thing or the right now thing? I like, no, God promised me this, but I could get this right now. I actually love Boaz's character because he said, listen, I'm gonna be honest. There's somebody else, but let me do my thing. I'm not going to leave you questioning if I want to pursue you. Man, listen, I'm talking from what Boaz's heart is that a godly man never leaves the woman that he loves in question. Do he really want me? I don't know. That's not God. That's the right now thing. The godly man is going to say, hey, I want to marry you. I got some work to do. Man, I'm going to give y'all this right. Man, me and Michelle had a conversation, Starbucks. Are we going to remember it? Woo! We're sitting there at Starbucks. We're sitting down. I said, Michelle, what do I have to do in order to marry you? Right? She wrote the requirements on the paper.
That's right.
I remember that. She was like, you got to make X amount of dollars. I looked, I said, man, that's a big jump. Man, I need to pray some more. Right? But nevertheless, I picked that paper up, folded it up, went to work.
All right.
Why? Because if you desire, you make it happen.
Hey, come on with that. Say it, preacher.
You know what I'm saying? You make it happen.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. So what happens is that he says, hey, tomorrow morning, listen. Boaz didn't say, I'm going to wait 6 months. He said, tomorrow morning,
we're
going to get this done.
Right.
I'm going down to City Hall. We're going to fill out this paperwork. You about to be my boo. So what the scripture tells us is that in the morning, he actually didn't leave her empty-handed. He said, man, I'm going to show you I'm good on my promise. He got 6 scoops of barley and put it in her clothes and said, take that to your mother-in-law to let her know that I'm about to go do business.
All right.
When her mom came back, her mom didn't celebrate the leftovers. She didn't. She said, oh, that's nice, but let's see what he's going to do.
That's a mother. Come on.
You know what I'm saying? Sometimes we're celebrating on that. I got you flowers. Mom, like, Man, I'm about to step on some toes. Sometimes we're celebrating on the simple fact that the guy said, I want to marry you. Right? We celebrate. He said he's going there. Mom, like, let's see. Why? Promises ends nowhere. Actions is everything. Okay, I got 4 minutes. I'm 4 minutes over, but I'm trying to wrap this up. This is good. Chapter 4, right? Chapter 4. What's the point I pulled out of chapter 4? He said this. For God to give you extra in your life, you must be willing to risk your own inheritance. What you think is owed to you. I love this. Let's look at Ruth chapter 4. Verses 3 and 6, it says this. It says, then he said to the Redeemer, this is the other one. This the right now guy. He came to the Redeemer. This Boaz, he's talking. He's like, hey, check this out, homie. Noemi has come back from her country of Moab and is selling the parcels of lands that belong to her relative Elimelech. Verse 4. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, buy it in the presence of the sitting here. So what we're saying is that Boaz comes and sits in the midst of the elders.
Smart.
The elders are like the judges, the court. Whatever go down here is legit.
All right, it's official.
Right? So he caught him in the front. He said, man, say that you're going to buy it, sign the papers, say you're going to buy it in the presence of the elders of my people. And if you're willing to redeem it, redeem it. What you going to do? Right? Salesman tactics. I don't know about my salesmans in here. They make a decision now. Don't let them leave. Don't let them walk out. They got to do it now. Right? Redeem it. But if you will not, tell me that I might know. For there is no one besides you to redeem it, and I that come after you. He said, listen, it's either me or you.
All right.
If you're going to do it, tell me right now so I can go finish this up. If not, I leave, but guess what? It's just me and you. And he says, I will redeem it. I actually love the Redeemer because he looked at the short-term gain and he says, I want that. I want the land. I want the power. I actually want the fame. Verse 5. Boaz is tricky. He's smart. He said, then Boaz said, the day you buy the field from the hands of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite.
Something attached to it. Come on.
The widower of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance. Listen what he's saying. Look, once you buy the land from Naomi, you have to have a baby by Ruth, so that when that baby get older, it can take back
Whoa.
The land.
The long term, that's right. That's
I want the short term, but I don't want the long term commitment and cost.
You don't
want
to give it up. Come on.
I don't want the cost. This is what I'm saying. If you God is going to do extra in hell, you must be willing to lose your inheritance. He said this in verse 6. Then the Redeemer says, I cannot redeem it for myself. Fool, you just said a couple verses ago that you were going to redeem it. I can't do it. Why? Lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it. Listen. Christ is our Redeemer.
Yes.
Right. Whoever was to redeem Ruth was willing to lose it all to get her.
All right.
Yes.
Everything. Everything. His land, the land that he acquired, he was willing to lose it all. But I'm so happy that we have a bounce back God. A bounce back guy. I'm gonna talk about this bounce back guy, and we're gonna wrap it up. Romans 8:11 says this. Okay, he said this. If the spirit of him who raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give you life to your mortal body through his spirit who dwells in you. This is what it said. Our God is a bounce back God. Nothing could get him down. Nothing could hold him down. He was ready to get back up. And I actually said, what can I show you an illustration of a bounce back God? So I went on Amazon and I bought a ball. This is God. This ball is designed to bounce. It's designed to bounce. No matter how hard I want to keep it down, I can't keep it down.
All right.
No matter how hard I want to crush it, I can't crush it. It's designed to bounce back. Right? God is saying some of you guys are designed to bounce. Some of you guys are designing to bounce. And I was thinking about the illustration in the shower a couple weeks ago, and I got super excited because I said to myself, everyone is going to say to me, Justin, I know this ball is designed because it's a rubber ball. And rubber balls bounce. And I said, awesome. So I went to Amazon, I got a second one. The same rubber ball. Can't bounce. You want to know why? It don't have what it needs inside of it. Man, listen. I want to say this right now. What? You over here talking about what I'm made out of. It don't matter what you're made out of. It matters what the God that's inside of you. That the God of the bounce back is inside of you. No matter what happens, you're going to bounce back. I don't care. If you lose your job, you bounce back. If you got a divorce, you bounce back. If you're sick, you bounce back. Why? Because we worship the God of the bounce back. Just an ordinary ball. Without the extra.
Hallelujah.
But when you have the extra,
yes,
you can bounce back.
Right. So,
so this is what I'm going to say. 10 minutes over. Got to wrap it up. I want to say this. Hey, everyone is in a different path in your life.
Yes.
You might be saying, man, Justin, I have been going through so much in my life, and I feel like God has been trying to crush me. I have had bad relationships. I have lost jobs. I have lost money, and I feel like my life is doomed. I'm inviting you to invite the extra in your life.
Yes.
I'm inviting you to allow someone who can turn ordinary into extraordinary. Yes, yes. What you believe is true. You were made to bounce back. But you don't have the life inside of you. What the Bible says is that when God comes, he blows pneuma. The Holy Spirit inside of this. This is how you feel. You feel crushed. You feel like Noemi. I'm empty. There's nothing inside of me. I can't bounce back. I can't have another son. I can't do what I want to do, really do. She said, I'm old. I can't have a baby. But the verse that we started off with is that at the end of the story,
yes,
she was breastfeeding the baby. And everyone said, that's your baby. Man, listen. Listen, there's so many births and dreams that's inside of you, and that God is saying, if you will let me fill you up, I'm going to birth that desire out of you.
Yes.
It didn't take 10 years. It took him 1 year. It said, by next season, she had a baby. I'm letting you know, they did that right on the merry night. They said by next year, that baby was there by harvest. They didn't wait 2 months, they got busy. Listen, what you think in your life that's going to take a lifetime for it to happen, God said, I could turn it over in a year. So this is what I'm saying. This is my proposal to you. Let's have a chat. I'm just going to go straight into the next step. Let's have a chat. Because maybe you're saying, what do I need to do in order for me to be in this relationship with God? To actually have God actually see me, look at me, and love me as I need to be loved. Here go, the first thing I want to say is that let's have a conversation. Man, I would love to talk to you about what it means to be saved and live for Christ. Right? Like the real thing, like the stuff in the Bible that's pretty on point. Right? I would love to walk through scripture and talk to you about what does it mean for you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and for you to take on his name. A lot of people just stop with this idea of just, man, I accepted Jesus in my life. But have you taken on his name?
Yes.
Have you taken over his name? And that's really what we would love to talk to you about, taking on the name of Christ. Right? Taking on the name of Christ. Here, the second thing that what the scripture tells us and promises us is that once we take over the name of Christ, we shall be filled.
Amen, amen.
Maybe you've been baptized and you're like, Pastor Jester, I took God Christ's name on, but I'm still crushed. I still don't got the hope in the areas I need to have hope. I like still don't got the resilience that I need to have. He said, I need to fill you. The process isn't over. I would love to live in your heart. Man, that's a love like no other. He said, I would love to just blow in all of me inside of you.
Yes, Lord.
So we would love to have a chat. We would love to actually talk to you about what it means to be baptized in the name of Jesus and what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit and what that looks like in your life. So have a chat with us. If you're not here and you leave, then you can always email me. My email is justin.william@graceandtruth.org. Always send me an email, right? Because maybe you just don't feel comfortable. Maybe you're watching it online at a later time, but in your heart, you're saying, man, what he said is exactly what I need. I want to bounce back.
Yes.
I like want to be resilient. So send an email. I would love to talk to you. Here, the second thing I'm going to talk to you about, joining the group. Ruth and Noemi. There is no Ruth without Noemi.
Right. Yes.
You have to be
connected
to the people God calls you to be connected to in your life. Why? Because even though Ruth has everything, she's young, she got everything, she needs the godly wisdom.
All right.
Yes.
She needs the godly wisdom. And many times, you might be like, I'm trying to do this Christian thing, and it's been hard. I've been going to church after church, and it's just hard. Get in a group. We have godly women that are reading the Book of Ruth. The reason why we're studying the Book of Ruth is because our women leads was pressed in their hearts to say, we want to see what the women of the Bible do. And I'm like, man, that's awesome. Me and the brothers tried to steal that same idea, right? But it's really this ideal is that you need people to say, let's look at Scripture.
Right.
Let's look at Scripture. Let's look at wisdom. And actually ask, how does that help us? Here, the next thing, after you join the group, after you accepted Jesus Christ and you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, join the team.
Right.
Be active, right?
The ministry.
Right? Join the team. Join the active, right? Let God, whatever he's been ready, birth after you, be of greatness. Listen, Ruth is a Moabite. She's a Moabite. He birthed greatness out of her.
Hallelujah.
Man, I'm about to mess y'all up.
Jesus.
But Boaz's mama was Rahab.
Yes.
All right. That's right.
Who's Rahab? Man, I actually love how the he go to Bible describe it. It said Rahab the prostitute. His past wasn't beautiful. Her past wasn't beautiful,
ordinary.
But together they birthed the father of the king.
Yes. Jesus. Amen.
God just wants you to be available, right? So join the team, become available, and God will birth something amazing out of you. He doesn't care about your past. All he cares about is your surrenders. Let us pray. Heavenly Father God, we just thank you, God. Father God, we just thank you for this message, God. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity, God. Father God, we praying, God, for someone might hear this message and that something inside of them might start turning, God. And Father God, that they might have the desire to bounce back. To actually say, God, I want you to fill me up so that no matter what this life can give me, I always can bounce back. I always can bounce forward. I always can do what you call me to do. Father God, I actually pray, God, that heart, that mind, God, might be bubbling in some of our brothers and sisters that are in this church today. And Father God, that they might have a moment today in history that will change their life forever. Father God, I'm also going to say a special prayer for my singles, God. That Father God, that they're navigating, God. Father God, I pray, God, that they don't choose the right now. But God, they choose the one that you have destined for them. Father God, I actually pray, God, that they are not choosing based on looks and what tickle their eyes. But Father God, they're seeking, they're made to have a heart that please you.
Yes.
It's something that amazing that you can do with two people who have a heart seeking to please you. You birth amazing things out of them.
Yes.
So Father God, we're praying for impact in our ministry. We're praying for impact in our families. Father God, we pray for the current marriages in our church, God. That Father God, that the husband and wife might get on one accord. And that Father God, that you might flow some amazing things through them. Father God, we're praying for an increase in the impacity of our ministry, God. That as we are doing the ordinary, dear God, that you sprinkle some extra on that. That, Father God, as we are just walking down the street, dear God, that you set up, we so happen to come by a situation that we are there to minister the gospel, to share the gospel, to be there. Father God, this is our heart, God, that God, that you use every single one of us in our church. Father God, we're praying for the hearts of the members. We're actually praying for the heart of our ministry. Do what you only you can do. God, we thank you and we love you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. 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 I love everyone, and I see you next week. All right, love you. Amen.